Today we'll be talking about nuclear magnetic resonance. If you haven't heard the name before, well, you probably heard the name maybe under the term MRI, magnetic resonance imaging. So when you go to the hospital and there's an MRI machine, it uses the exact same physical phenomena than nuclear magnetic resonance. Actually, MRI is using nuclear magnetic resonance for doing imaging. It's just they removed the nuclear part because patient didn't like to go into a nuclear machine at the hospital. They were getting, no, seriously, that's the only reason why it's called. It's not called nuclear magnetic resonance imaging. So NMR was the very first technology used for experimentally implementing quantum information processing idea. And yes, and I mentioned it a little bit. Mikhaly Moskov was on the team that did it. It was in Oxford, and it was in 1997. They did a small two-qubit experiment called, I think it was the Deutsch-Jose algorithm or the Grover algorithm. You will hear about it tomorrow, and maybe if you feel like it, we can implement it next Friday in the lab. NMR has been around since the 50s. It was discovered by Purcell and a few other people. And it's a technology that is heavily used in chemistry, in pharmaceutical. It's used a lot for getting an idea of the dynamics of molecules and shape of molecules. But turns out that in the mid-90s, we find out that it had all the characteristics to do quantum computing. Almost all the characteristics. So if we have time at the end, I will discuss a little bit the shortcomings of NMR and then why, in some sense, NMR, as I will speak today, you know, liquid state nuclear magnetic resonance is not a scalable quantum computer. It is a prototype. It works just fine. We have incredible precision on top of it. It still has the world record of the most qubit individually universally controlled, which is 12. It was done here at IQC, but also with our colleagues at MIT. Well, that they are now working here. It was the team of David Corey. But back it was still in MIT. So that was already three, 4 years ago. And we haven't gone any further than 12 qubits because of the shortcoming I was talking about. And hopefully I'll have time to mention a little bit about it. So let's dive right into it. So it will be your first time seeing an actual experimental implementation or the idea of an experimental implementation of quantum computing. So the first thing you need for doing quantum computing experimentally is you need a well-behaved two-level system. You need something that you can encode your quantum zero and your quantum one. You need a quantum bit. And nuclear magnetic resonance, in a nutshell, what we do is we control, manipulate, and read out the spin of nucleus within a molecule. So if you take a molecule, I'll take one very simple. Let's say a hydrogen carbon like this with a chlorine here, chlorine there, chlorine there. That's called a TC, the trichloroethylene. It's a molecule that we used to use a lot. And if you look at each molecule, so hydrogen's got one proton. That's its nuclei. Carbon normally has 12. Chlorine has, I don't remember. So the hydrogen, its nuclei is a proton. Every elementary particle has a charge. They have a mass or no mass. They have a size or no size. But when you start going at the quantum level, they have something more that we call the spin. Have you all seen spin in your quantum mechanics course? So you're vaguely familiar with it, right? So spin, in some sense, that it's an intrinsic magnetic dipole moment that every particle have. And then you've seen the addition of spins is that, for example, in carbon here, you have six proton, six neutron. So if you had two spin 1/2, you get a spin 0 or a spin 1. If you have three, you have a spin 1/2 or a spin 3/2. No, four, you have spin 0, spin 1, spin 2, and so on and so forth. So a carbon 12 has spin, well, technically it has spin 0. In its ground state, it has spin 0. But we can actually ask our chemist friend to give us a molecule, to synthesize a molecule with only carbon 13. It's possible to do. It costs lots of money, but they can do it. So here, for example, carbon 13 will be also a spin 1/2 nuclei. And there's many of them that has a spin 1/2 nuclei. So hydrogen, carbon, there's nitrogen 15, there's fluorine 19, phosphorus, silicon 29, There's a whole bunch. But you know, we're just, as far as we're concerned right now, let's just work with hydrogen and carbon. They're very well behaved. We like them. They're good. So you all know what a spin is. So let's look at how spin behave a little bit. So let's say pretty much from now on, I'm always going to assume that I have a large magnetic field pointing in the Z direction. Okay. Let's go back classically a little bit. Let's not talk about spin. But let's say I use a magnet with a south pole and a north pole, and I just put it in the magnetic field and let it go. What's going to happen? It's going to align with the magnetic field. Right? So now it's going to rotate all the way until it's aligned. Now instead, if I use a bar magnet like this, but I give it some angular momentum, I make it spin around it, what I'm going to create is I'm going to create a magnetic dipole. Now if I use a magnetic dipole and put it in the magnetic field, what is going to happen? It will precess. So it's like it's the rule of thumb. If you have a magnetic dipole pointing in one direction with a magnetic field, then you're going to have a torque that is perpendicular. So it's going to start precessing. It's just a little bit that maybe in high school your teacher did that. He took a bicycle wheel, make it spin very fast, and then hang it on the rope, and then it started turning around. Right? It's the same idea. So you have a torque, and it just starts precessing. So what's going to happen is around a magnetic field, it's just going to go, well, it's going to start precessing. Okay. Well, it turns out a spin, which as I mentioned is sort of an intrinsic quantum magnetic dipole, will also do that. And then you know, one of the first things I'm going to show you is you know, try to make you understand from the framework of quantum mechanics that it actually does that. But before going on, let's just introduce some notation that we're going to be using. So spin 1/2, they behave according, not they behave, but the operator representation of the spin is given by the Pauli matrix that we've seen yesterday, or that we also call the spin matrix. So the particularity with a quantum spin is that it doesn't point in any direction. Like here, a classical dipole, you can make it point in any direction. A spin 1/2 can only point in two directions. When you put it in the magnetic field, it has two possible states: pointing along the magnetic field or pointing against the magnetic field. So something we call up and something we call down. And it's something that can behave quantum mechanically, so you can put it in any superposition of those. And that's the whole point of NMR, or a big chunk of NMR, is how you go from a given state to a superposition, so how you do control. And then that's a good chunk of the lecture we're going to be going through. So I say there's two states. Up, that we're going to denote like this. And down, that we're going to denote like this. And then right there you see that a spin 1/2 is a natural qubit. Call that 0, call that 1. There's no other state. That's the only two possible states. And then we'll see another thing, like when you're going to see optics or when you're going to see superconducting qubit, is that there are many more states, or an infinite amount of states, but you need to restrict yourself to two. Here we only have two states, so it's a natural cube. And I said they only have two states, so they only have two states, so they will behave according to the Pauli matrices. So which essentially mean that if you take the operator Sz multiplied by the up state, you get h bar over 2 times the up state minus h bar over 2 times the down state. And here, so essentially your spin operator is h bar over 2 times 0, 0, 0 minus 1. And if we want to bring back to our notation that we were using yesterday, it's just h bar over 2 times the Z Pauli matrix. Okay? And at the same time, because it behaves according to the Pauli matrix, you can also define Sx as h bar over 2 times your x Pauli matrix. which is just as a reminder, 0110. Minus I0. Okay, so that's a notation that we're going to be using. It's nothing new for you. If you read in the literature, some books are going to work with the S matrix. I prefer to use the Pauli matrix because it's easier to relate to quantum information processing, where we don't use a factor 1/2 in front. And by the way, from now on, h bar equal 1. It's annoying to carry the h bar all the time, so we're just going to set it to 1. Okay, now, let's look at the energy and the behavior of a single spin 1/2. Right now, we're just going to look at single spin, and then we'll go to multiple spin. So classically, the energy associated with the magnetic dipole is given by minus its magnetic dipole moment dot product with the magnetic field. That's classical. Quantum mechanically is the same thing. It's just now we work quantum mechanically, so we work with operators. So quantum mechanically is you have a certain magnetic dipole in the x direction times the x direction, which is given by your spin operator. And I said we're always going to assume that the magnetic field is in the z direction. So we're going to call it B. Let's say B naught, and that pointing in the z direction. So now quantum mechanically, the Hamiltonian, which is the operator that represents the energy of your system, which also encapsulates all the dynamics of your system, would be given by minus mu z as z, or in some sense, if we want to go back to our quantum information notation, would be this. And just for the sake of it, so I will not go through all the arguments, but this mu z here encapsulates an intrinsic value of the molecule or the spin you're looking at. But it also encapsulates the fact that because you have electrons surrounding it, it shields the magnetic field a little bit and might change the dipolar moment and stuff. But for now on, let's just assume that we work with a pure spin of some sort. We're going to call it gamma over 2 z. And this, I completely forgot to add the b. You guys should have caught me on this. Now this value, this gamma here, we call it the gyromagnetic ratio, okay? And this is an intrinsic value of each element of the periodic table, okay? Hydrogen has a gyromagnetic ratio, the carbon has one, keep on going. And now, this value here, gamma times B is equal to, for now we're just going to call it omega 0. We're going to see that it's actually a frequency. This is what we call the Larmor frequency. Okay? When we are in the lab, we're going to use that term over and over and over and over and over and over again. Okay? So that being said, for a single spin, your Hamiltonian is given by omega naught over 2 times the z operator. And this is not only in NMR. You'll see that this kind of Hamiltonian pops up all the time. Good. Now, what is this Hamiltonian going to do to a given state? Schrödinger equation, d phi over dt is equal to minus I h phi. This is a very simple ordinary linear equation. My Hamiltonian is time independent. So I can solve that very easily to phi of t is equal to e to the minus I h bar operator h times phi of 0. Okay? Are we comfortable with this? Because we'll be using it over and over again. Okay? So in some sense, that means that for if I let my system evolve for a given time, what we call the propagator, or the unitary evolution, unitary operation the system will undergo, is given simply by e to the minus I ht. Okay? Now let's look. Assume my initial state is any superposition. Now I want to see what's going to happen. Okay? So at a certain time t, then it's u of t times phi of 0, then you just distribute alpha. So now u of t is e to the minus I h bar t 0 plus up plus beta e to the minus I h t down, which I omega naught zt over 2 . Okay, so now I have the exponential of a given operator applied to one of its eigenstate. So do you guys know what this is equal to? Not in term of operator, but if you apply it as an operator, what would be the output? That is right. But also here, because up is a eigenstate of the z operator with eigenstate 1, then if you take what I'm saying is, like, if you have a function, let's say any function of z apply on up, because up is an eigenstate of z with eigenvalue 1, so it's just like having the function evaluated at 1. Okay, you can easily prove that. And for this case here, you can easily prove that by, remember yesterday I said something you should never forget is e to the minus, you know, I theta, any poly matrix is equal to cos of theta times the identity plus I sine of theta times the poly matrix. You can easily prove that. So what I'm saying here is that this would be equal to alpha e to the minus I omega naught t over 2 times up plus, here's the same thing, it's just that down is an eigenstate of the z operator with a minus 1 value. So beta e to the plus I omega naught t over 2 times down. Is that good? Okay, for simplicity, just say alpha is equal to beta is equal to 1, square root of 1 half. So my initial state is equal to 1 over square root of 2 up plus down. What is the state? The plus state, which is an eigenvalue of an eigenstate of the operator x. So in some sense, on the Bloch sphere, this is a state pointing along the x direction. Just for the fun of it right now, let's see what are my expectation value of my x operator as a function of time. So phi of t x phi of t, which is equal to phi of 0 u of t dagger x u of t phi of 0. But that we already calculated here. So let's plug that in. So we will get something like, so we take the complex conjugate of this, so we'll get e to the plus I omega naught t over 2 bra up plus e to the minus I omega naught t over 2 bra down, the x operator, and then e to the minus I omega naught t over 2 up plus e to the plus I omega naught t down. Okay, now we're just going to start doing operator thing. This is the x operator. If I apply the x operator on state up, what do I get? Down, right? From the lecture we saw yesterday in more on the quantum information, this is the not gate. So it means it takes the up to the down and the down to the up. So this will be equal to this big bracket here times e to the plus I omega naught t up plus e to the minus I omega naught, so it's over 2, t over 2, down. And then you take this, you multiply by that. So the up, tensor product with up gives you 1, tensor product with down gives you 0. So you will pick up e to the plus I omega naught, plus I omega naught t plus e to the minus I omega naught t. And something that I forgot is that I have the square root of 2 here, so I forgot to, there was a 1/2 factor in front here. Do you guys know what that is? That's cosine. Cosine of omega naught t. And similarly, that's an exercise, which is essentially the same mechanics. You will find that the expectation value of y as a function of time is equal to sine omega naught t. So what does that give us? So what does that describe? It's a circular motion. So we start on a block sphere along the y, the x direction, and as a function of time, my x behave as a cosine and my y behave as a sine. So that's the definition of a circular motion. And this is exactly what I was arguing with the classical approach, is that, you know, if you have a dipolar moment in a magnetic field, it's going to start rotating. So what it says here is if you have along the x direction, along the y direction, then your state rotate, and it rotate at a velocity omega naught, which is given by the Larmor frequency. So that's why we call it, that's why omega naught, we call it the Larmor frequency, because it is a frequency. Okay? And just a quick recall, the Larmor frequency was equal to gamma times b, gamma being an intrinsic value of every molecule. And just so you know, gamma is, let's say for a couple, is equal to like 42.58 megahertz per Tesla times the magnetic field. That's for hydrogen. And then for carbon, it's 16.55 megahertz per Tesla times B naught. That's for carbon 13 in each, so it's about a quarter of the other one. And downstairs in the lab, we work with magnets of the order of 10 to 15 Tesla. So one of the magnets you'll be working with, for example, the hydrogen goes at 600 megahertz. The other one goes at 400 megahertz. We have one here on campus that goes up to 700 megahertz, and commercially you can buy all the way up to 1 gigahertz. But then it's become, you need a gymnasium to put it. It's pretty big. So any question on this? This is just, I wanted to go through this just to show you why spin. Okay, but also give you a bit of exercise of the mechanics of going through the math of quantum mechanics. Okay, any question before we move on? It's all good? Okay, so now we've used the Hamiltonian, but I said the Hamiltonian represent the eigenstate and eigenvalue. The eigenvalue of a Hamiltonian is the energy of your system. So we had the Hamiltonian is equal to omega naught over 2 times the Z operator. So if you look from an energy diagram perspective, is if you have no B field, then your spin up and your spin down are exactly the same energy. There's no discretization. Because then, you know, there's no Larmor frequency. This is zero. The Hamiltonian is nothing. There's no energy. So it's not preferable to be in the up state or the negative state. Then if you apply a B field, then you get a separation. So then here you have the down state, the up state with energy with energy omega naught over 2. And here you have the down state with energy minus omega naught over 2. So that the difference between the two of them, delta E, is equal to omega naught. And this is something you remember, in your early quantum mechanics course when you started looking at the hydrogen atom or the spectrum, the emission spectrum of radiation spectrum of some atoms. They say, you know, the energy of the photon being emitted is the difference between the excited energy level and the ground energy level. So this is here. It's sort of the same idea. It's because you have a splitting in the energy level of omega naught. Then if you send some omega naught energy or some it's not really photon that we do here because we work with radio wave. We don't really call it photon there. But if you send some radiation at omega naught, you'll be able to induce some transition between the two. And so that's sort of the hand-wavy way that is given from the early days of quantum mechanics. But we'll go through the mechanism to show you that, yes, if you actually send a magnetic field that has this exact frequency, then you will start creating transition between those two states. And this is what quantum control means. Right? You start from a known state, then you want to create a superposition. So you want to create transition, you want to excite it. And then we're going to go through to show you how you can excite it very precisely. So that argument I just made is the hand-wavy physics argument type of thing. I'm going to bring you the school backyard argument instead, which is, as far as I'm concerned, more a bit more easy to understand. So you have a spin that constantly spins around the x-axis, the z-axis. And now, so it's in the Bloch sphere representation, it spins around. Now you want to rotate it, right? Michaelis talked yesterday that any one qubit operation can be seen as a rotation around a certain x-axis for a certain angle. So now we want to find a way to rotate that spin. But that spin is constantly moving around. So one thing you can tell me is that, well, if you want to make it rotate, then apply a magnetic field in another direction. So then you're going to start rotating around this one, which would make sense. But now the problem is you will have one magnetic field this way, and you need the Z magnetic field because that's what gives you your quantization. That's what gives you your 2-qubit state. You apply it in a different, you apply another one, so all of a sudden, you will have two different fields that will create you a field that is sort of, you know, at 45 degrees, but at a certain angle. But at that point, you will start your quantization. Your quantization will now be along this axis. Or maybe you can say, well, then maybe I still look at it as a quantization like that, but that it spins around like this, but it keeps on spinning in the Z direction. So let's say you want to do a next rotation, but it's constantly spinning in the Z direction. And rotation is non-commutative. So it means that if, now every time you do a Z rotation followed by an X rotation, it's different than an X rotation followed by a Z rotation. So if you try to do the both of them together, you're going to get completely mixed up because you cannot keep track of what's going on. So instead, we're going to do something a little smarter. And this is where the part of resonance comes in. Instead of seeing the spin rotating, or looking at what we call the lab frame, where we just sit, stand back and look at the spin rotating, we're going to put ourselves sitting on the spin. And then at that point, if I send a magnetic field that is rotating at the exact same frequency than the spin, as far as the spin is concerned, it only sees a constant magnetic field pointing in one direction. It's just like, that's why I was talking the school backyard example. You know the merry-go-round thing that goes around? If you're sitting on one of those and it's spinning around and you try to talk with your friend who's on the ground, you won't really be able to talk at all, like only when you're going to pass by each other, but the rest of the time you're going to go, right? So what you do is you tell your friends, like, no, get on your feet and run at the same speed than me. Then he won't talk much because he's out of breath. But then, as far as you're concerned, your friend is always right next to you, and you can talk just fine. So this is exactly what we're going to do. Is we're going to send a magnetic field that rotates in a certain direction. So essentially what I'm saying is we're going to redefine a reference frame so that the X and the Y axis rotates at the same frequency as the spin. And then at that point, the spin will see a constant magnetic field in a given direction or a given phase, and it will start rotating around it. This is the intuitive part. But we are talking about quantum mechanics, so there's nothing really intuitive about it. So let's just go see if we can actually make it happen. So we already saw that if you have a state in a given superposition, the natural Hamiltonian will make it rotate around the z-axis. So in some sense, what we're saying is, as a function of time, it's equal to a z rotation of omega naught t times your initial state. Okay, and just where by definition, e to the minus I omega naught over 2, the 1/2 here is very important. And there's a 1/2 because we're talking about spin 1/2. Okay. So what we can do, if we want to set ourselves in the rotating frame, then we can define a state, I'm gonna call it twiddle, as e to the minus omega r t. R is sort of the rotating frame velocity, rotating frame frequency, times phi of t. Okay, which in some sense, if you look, it's equal. That's a quick exercise to do. So if you look at it that way, it's naturally my spin is always spinning, and now I define. It's a definition. It's a mathematical tool. I define a frame so that every time, what I call my state is the state that's been rotated, and I rotate it back by a given angle. And here you see that if, for example, if I really put myself, if I really use a rotating frame at the exact same frequency than my Larmor frequency, then the state in my rotating frame is just, those two will cancel, that will give you a zero rotation, would just be stationary at my initial state. So I will not assume that omega r is equal to omega naught just for general purpose, because in general we don't always go directly in the frame of the spin. But just for now, let's keep it that way. So now we want to look at how does this thing behave. I mean, it's a mathematical construction. As far as we know, it might not even be a quantum state. So we just take the time derivative of this, just to see.
And I will not go through all the details.
But it's in your, I've gone on the details in the notes. But what you can see is that at the end, and you should go through. So, we have this. What does this equation look like? D phi over dt is equal to minus I something times phi. That's Schrodinger equation, right? So, in the reference frame, the quantum state that I define still follow an equation of motion that is exactly the same as a Schrodinger equation. So essentially I can say, well, this is my quantum state, and I can just keep on going with that. And now you can define, so that's what we're going to define. We're going to define our state in our reference frame as this. And it behaves according to an Hamiltonian in the reference frame given by H. Twiddle. You got Rz minus omega Rt, the H in the lab frame, minus omega R. Sorry. And this is, in some sense, some variation of the Dirac picture of quantum mechanics. You know, there's the Heisenberg picture, there's the Schrodinger picture, there's the Dirac picture. It's kind of a scene of that. And in some sense, you can also treat this as perturbation. But, you know, it's not going into too much detail. So let's just look at it, just to see if it makes sense and what it implies. And just to see if our intuition was good. So, sanity check. Say omega r is equal to omega naught. Okay? And we use as before our what would be our Hamiltonian? In the our Hamiltonian in the reference frame. So Rz, so a rotation, so you have sandwiched the Hamiltonian between a z rotation. But our Hamiltonian only has a z operator in it. So everything commutes, right? So that one canceled with this one. So you're just back with omega naught over 2z. And then minus omega naught over. So in my reference frame, in my rotating frame, I have no Hamiltonian anymore. There's no behavior, which makes sense because we saw here that, you know, if my rotating frame rotates at the same frequency as my spin, then the state is stationary. Stationary means that, well, it's either an eigenvalue of your Hamiltonian, an eigenstate of your Hamiltonian, or it just means that there's no dynamics. No dynamics means no Hamiltonian. So the sanity check holds. And by the way, this is one example of what we call a rotating frame. But this is a widely used mathematical tool. You say, let's define a state that is given by a unitary operation of my actual state. And then you work through that. And sometimes you end up with equations that are this huge, that don't even make sense. But this is a very powerful tool that you can use in quantum mechanics, especially in control theory. But we're not going to get into those details right now. Time is going slow. Perfect. Okay, any question so far? Because most of the thing we'll be talking about from now on will be in the rotating frame. And when we go in the LAM, we always talk about the rotating frame. So always picture yourself in the rotating frame. Okay, so this was mathematical tool number one. Now let's go to the idea of spin control. And here, actually, there's a reason why NMR is the very first system we teach. Because turns out, in many systems, the Hamiltonian are always very similar. Not exactly the same, but very similar. You'll find out that when Adrian's going to start talking about a superconducting qubit, which is like a construction of some sort, there's huge mathematics and electronic circuit that behave quantum mechanically, it's all weird and stuff, but when it boils down at the very end, the Hamiltonian is extremely similar to NMR, and the control Hamiltonian is very similar to NMR, and the coupling Hamiltonian is very similar to NMR. So that's why we start from there, because everything, you can always refer back to what NMR is. If you understand the math and the physics in there, you're in good shape. Okay, so spin control. So essentially spin control means go from phi to any phi prime. And yesterday you saw with Michele that really at the end of the day, the only thing you need is being able to do rotations around two non-parallel axes in the on the block sphere. Okay? So this is what we'll be doing. Like, so you've heard about the Hadamard gate, the T gate. Those are computer scientists terminology. In physics, most of the time we do rotation. And then we'll see how we can do rotation. So I already explained that. I already gave you the idea that if I do a rotating magnetic field, then it gives me a constant in the rotating frame. It will give me a constant magnetic field pointing in a certain direction, and then the spin will start processing around it. Okay. Now, how do you create a rotating magnetic field? So here, remember, we're working with hundreds of megahertz of precession frequency. So you cannot really have a magnet that rotates at 100 megahertz. Right? Mechanically, it's impossible. But there's something that we know. If you take a nice little coil like this, and you can even, if you're fancy or electrical engineer, you can even put a capacitor to give it the LC circuit. If you attach that to an AC volt source, then when you get here, you will get an AC current, but the B field inside the coil is proportional to the current you put in. So if you put an AC current, you get an AC magnetic field. So you get a magnetic field that will go back and forth. It's not quite what we want, but so you get what we call a BRF. I'm going to call it RF because it's radio frequency. In the hundreds of megahertz, it's radio frequency. You're going to get something like a certain value times, cosine of omega RF T plus phi. Phi is just any phase that your current can have. So what's a cosine? So cosine is up and down, or sideways. But let's say up and down for now. If I do this, and then you add the both together, what does that give me? Up and down, right? So what I'm saying is that this is, so let's do this in the x direction. And here, okay, this is not the operator, but this is the small vector x. I'm just going to say this is purely just a mathematical construction. My favorite mathematical trick, which is adding zero. So I added a sign here, and I added a minus sign here. So I've done nothing again. This rotates in the direction of my spin.
That's what we call resonant.
So that one rotates in the same direction of my spin. This one, because there's a minus here, rotates in the other direction. This is non-resonant. So let's go back to the merry-go-round example. Yes? Oh, sorry. You're sharp. Excellent. Some people are listening. Yes. So let's go back to the merry-go-round example. So if you're on the merry-go-round and you turn around and you ask your friend, get up and run in the opposite direction, then you will even be able, you will be able to talk even less. And without going into the details of everything, is because we work at such high frequency in the hundreds of hertz that this part here physically can really be ignored to parts per billion. So we can really just completely ignore that part to a very, very, very good approximation. So now I found a way to create an approximate, but very high approximate, rotating field. Okay, so now let's go back. If I turn on my magnetic field, my RF magnetic field, now all of a sudden I have my Hamiltonian original, just the fact that I have a magnetic field, plus a Hamiltonian due to my RF. Okay? This is omega naught over 2 Zen, but RF, the HRF here, just as before, would be equal to minus the dipolar moment dot product with the magnetic field. But now my magnetic field is in the x and the y direction. So it would be equal to gamma over 2. Actually, it's gamma over 4 because we have a 2 here. Gamma over 4 BRF. Cos omega RF T plus phi operator X plus sine omega RF T plus phi with a Y. Now, you can rewrite this. I'm just going to come back here, rewrite that. This thing here, so it's cos omega RF X plus cos omega RF Y. You can really just rewrite that as so this is just taking the X, this part here is just taking the X operator and rotating it by omega RT plus phi, which quantum mechanically, when you rotate an operator, is given by the Z rotation operator sandwiched between your operator. And this, if you're not familiar with that yet, do it as an exercise. Okay, so let's see where we're at now. If we put everything together, now we have a Hamiltonian that looks like omega naught over 2 Zen plus 1 over 4, actually, by the way, gamma over 2 BRF, if we're going to note it, as omega naught. And naught is for nutation. Because we'll see that because of this, it's going to make our spin mutate around an axis. So let's use that as a definition now. It'll make sense soon. Plus 1 over, omega naught over 2, RZ omega RF T plus phi, X omega Z So this is in the lab frame. So now let's go into
rotating frame that rotates at omega r is equal to omega rf.
So we go in the rotating frame of the pulse in some sense. And if you remember that little
formula I had before,
that would mean that if you go from your Hamiltonian to the other Hamiltonian, we'll end up with omega naught minus omega rf z over 2 plus omega naught over 2. Sorry. Just want to make sure I don't make any. So I got all the math detail in the notes, but this is what you will get at the end. Okay. Now we're just done mathematics. Let's analyze what we get. So this essentially this whole thing, this Hamiltonian, looks like if we had a magnetic field of this strength in the z direction, and a magnetic field of this strength in the, in this direction. So what it looks like this is a certain value so that in the plane, so that's the x, y, and z, so this will be given by phi, and then the polar angle will be given by sort of the rate, so that polar angle will be given by the tangent of so this guy would be 10 of the angle will be given by omega naught minus omega RF divided by omega nutation. So I've tossed that pretty quickly. Does it make sense? Or should I go over that a little slower? Okay. In some sense here, what it says is the magnetic field along the z direction looks like it's proportional to this strength. So this part here, the projection along the z axis, has this strength. And then the magnetic field on the plane, so in the xy direction, has this strength. So that projection is related to this. So the tangent, which is the cosine over the sine, the sine over the cosine, which is this one over that one, that will be omega naught minus RF minus omega rotation. Okay? So now, by working into the rotating frame, I've gone from a time-dependent, weird, hard-to-work-with Hamiltonian, because every time you have a time dependence in Hamiltonian, it's very hard to solve, to a time-independent Hamiltonian that looks just like a rotation about a certain angle, about a certain axis in the XYZ plane. Okay? Now, that being said, usually in the lab, omega naught is in the megahertz. Omega RF is very close to omega naught, or at least we try to make it close. And omega notation is, this is in the tens to hundreds. It's in the kilohertz to the low megahertz. But now the point is if you look at this, and if I send my pulse on resonance, so at the exact same frequency than my Larmor frequency, so omega RF equal omega naught, this part goes off. And I only have a rotation around an axis in the plane. Right? Or simply said, if omega naught minus omega RF is much smaller than omega nutation. So it's either you hit very close to the frequency, or if you hit not very close to the frequency, but you hit very hard, that's actually the term we use, the soft poles versus the hard poles. So even though you're off frequency by, let's say, kilohertz, if you really whack it with all the amplifiers you have without blowing your system, you will still do the rotation. It would just, so it would be just, that would imply a rotation along an axis in XY plane. One axis, the axis is dependent on phi. And phi is the phase that we give our current when we send it to the coil. And turns out we have an extremely good precision on phi. Everything is digitized, and in the lab we can go to, it's a 64 kilobit precision. So take 360 degrees divided by 65,000, that's how precise we can go. Okay? And we'll explain a little bit more in the lab when we see the machine and stuff, how the electronics works. But right now, let's stick to the theory and then the physics of things. And then we can do a rotation along any axis in the xy plane by angle given by theta is equal to omega nutation times tau. So you turn on your current very slow for a little bit, it's a short angle. You turn it on for a long time, you can get a large angle. And for practicality, right, in the lab, the problem is amplifiers are not necessarily, they're not linear, in the sense that if you do a pi over 2 with, let's say, 10 microseconds, it doesn't quite mean that if you do 5 microseconds, you will get a pi over 4. So what we do is we calibrate, we only use pi over 2 in pi pulse. But that phase is extremely precise. So essentially, in NMR, what we think is we can do, so in practice, any pi over 2 or pi rotation around any axis. Okay. This is our control. And that, just from a simple argument from Michele gave you yesterday, that gives you universal 1-qubit control. Okay, so if we have 2 qubits, then again, we're going to start looking at the Hamiltonian. So, just because you have 2 spins that are in a magnetic field, they both going to have a certain precession frequency. Okay? So, in the Hamiltonian, you say, well, this one here encapsulates the precession frequency of the first spin. This one here is the precession frequency of the second spin. By the way, here it's not a square, but it's a subscript 2. Okay? And just in case, just as a reminder, what I mean by this is Zen tensor product 1, which is equal to 1, 0, 0, minus 1, tensor product 1, 0, 0, 1, which is equal to, you put that and stuck it in there, 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1. Okay? And similarly, Z2 is equal to okay, so you've seen that yesterday with Michele. So, That's fine. That gives me a nice 2-qubit system or 2-spin system, but not really. That gives me 2 1-spin system. Okay? If we want to use that for quantum computing, we need to be able to make them interact. We need to create entanglement. Remember, Michele taught yesterday that if you have a universal 1-qubit control and one entangling gate, almost any entangling gate, then you have universal control. So, and turns out that thankfully there's always an interaction Hamiltonian that comes naturally, and I'll go through the different type of interaction Hamiltonian. So this is, I'm only going to talk about 2-spin, but that generalized to n spin. Right? If I had n of m, that would be the sum of all the n frequency plus all the interaction between each other. So in NMR, the interaction has mostly 2 components. There's 2 different types. In different systems, you have different components. But in NMR, we're going to concentrate on 2. One of them that we call direct dipole-dipole coupling, and one of them that we call the J-coupling, or the scalar coupling, or some of people even call it the Fermi coupling. The dipole-dipole, this is something that comes up just because the spin are magnetic moment. Because they're magnetic moments, they create a magnetic field. So if I have a spin here, say pointing a certain direction, and a spin there pointing in the other direction, then this guy create a magnetic field here, and this guy create a magnetic field there. So the presence of this guy here in a certain state creates a magnetic field at the outer place, which adds or subtracts, well, which adds to the already present magnetic Z magnetic field, which will modify the way it behaves. It will modify its precession frequency. Okay? This is just the fact that you have 2 magnets next to each other, they influence each other. Okay? And without going into too much detail, the Hamiltonian looks like, well, let's just call it D, 3Z1 tensor Z2 minus sigma 1 dot sigma 2. This is a sort of notation for sigma. Sigma is equal to the vector sigma x, y, Z, where D, so D theta, is equal to another constant times 3 cosine squared theta minus 1, where theta is the angle between the vector joining the 2-spin and the Z-axis. So if you have a spin here and a spin there, and this is my Z-axis, then this will be theta, okay? I'm not going to go to the detail of why it takes this form. We could talk for 5 hours on this. But essentially here, I'm talking mostly about liquid state NMR, okay? What we're going to do this week is liquid state. So we have a bunch of molecules together. I haven't explained why we have a bunch of molecules yet. I'll get there. But we have a bunch of molecules that are in liquid, and they move around each other and tumble on a much faster time scale than any dynamics we do. So we do things on the microsecond dynamics in megahertz, but those things move around on the picosecond and even faster. So what it means is that as far as we're concerned, everything averages out. So a little calculus example, if you do this and you average it over all angles, and here's spherical coordinates, right? So all possible solid angle, you'll find out that, well, the average strength of dipolar coupling is equal to 0. So in liquid state, there's no dipolar coupling, which also means that you put 2 molecules, if you put many molecules in the same sample, they won't interact with each other either. Okay? So dipolar coupling is gone. But typically, if you want to know, D is in normally in the kilohertz. Is it in the kilohertz range? Okay. So it's still quite weak compared to the Larmor frequency or the Z or what we call the Zeeman splitting. The other one is the J coupling or scalar coupling. And that one, if we take a molecule again, so a molecule, you have those valence bonds, so they share electrons. Okay, so there's a wave function of the electrons are on top of each other. And this fact creates an interaction between each molecule, let's say here the carbon and the hydrogen, via the electron. So you can kind of think of it as your first nuclei interact with the electron, who then goes interacting with the other nuclei, and it's like they were transferring interaction, and they were transferring information or some part of their wave function. Okay, so it's via the bond electron. Okay, and it's kind of a Fermi-type interaction. Every time you bring two fermions together, there's an interaction. And this one takes the form of pi over 2 j, so x1, x2, plus y1, y2, plus z1, z2. Okay? So essentially, that's what your Hamiltonian is for two qubits. Is you have a chunk here that we call the Zeeman interaction, so the Larmor frequency, Zeeman from the magnetic field, and a J coupling. And here our J is normally typically in the hundreds of hertz. It can go from 10 to 200 to 300. Okay, so it's a pretty slow process compared to megahertz. No, hundreds of megahertz, hundreds of hertz. So it's 10, you know, it's several order of magnitude lower. So I've went through the detail in the notes, but I will not do it here. But there's something that we call secular approximation, which means that if omega 1 minus omega 2, the difference between the two frequencies. Wait a minute. Just want to make sure I don't say something stupid. Yeah. So if the difference between the two Larmor frequencies, it's much smaller than the J coupling, then you can approximate to a very high precision. To only what we call a ZZ coupling. And what's the beauty with this? Is that actually is 1 minus 1. Yes, here I made a mistake. Is that now your interaction Hamiltonian is diagonal. Your other Hamiltonian, so your entire Hamiltonian is diagonal. And diagonal is extremely easy to deal with. So that's why NMR is good to get started, because you don't need to multiply a bunch of matrices all the time together. Everything is diagonal, everything is super well behaved, and everything is great. Okay, so now we have a Hamiltonian like this. So if we look at the energy level of this, well, we have four energy levels. Up, then you get omega naught 1 plus omega naught 2 omega naught, then that one is down, so we pick up a minus from there. And oh, sorry, z1, z2. Then the z1 we get a plus. And then a minus 1, so that will be minus
So essentially now, if you look at your energy level, you end up with four states of up, up, down, up, or down, but it, you know, it depends on the strength of the G coupling, or which one is bigger, omega 1 or omega 2. Yeah. And now it's kind of the same idea, is that if you look at this transition frequency, then you're flipping the second bit, the second spin. You're flipping the second spin given that the first spin is in down. Here's the other way around. You flip the second spin given that the first spin is in up. And here is the first spin splitting. Right? So if you look at the energy difference between those two and between those two, which is the energy difference between flipping the second bit, the difference in energy is only equal to pi j. Okay? So if I call that, let's say E1 and E2, then E1 minus E2, absolute value, is equal to pi j. So it means that if I can hit, if I can, you know, excite a transition with a power, kind of, you know, and this is really hand wavy argument, okay? But if I can send my nutation power or my RF field stronger so that my nutation frequency is faster than my J coupling, then I'll be able to excite both those transitions. So we'll be able to flip my spin, my second spin, no matter how my first spin is. And to be very honest, you don't have to hit that hard, right? This is very, this is only hundreds of hertz, and the BRF, you know, it's in the kilohertz. Okay. So what I'm saying here is, like, even though you have four energy states, you can still only flip the first spin and only flip the second spin. So if you send it, so here in our case, let's say we have hydrogen and carbon. Carbon, hydrogen is at 600 megahertz. So if I hit, you know, hard enough at 600 megahertz, I will flip my hydrogen independent of what the state of my carbon is. So I have an individual control. Same thing with the carbon. Okay? If you want to be very fancy, technically, we rarely do this, but we could. Technically, we could flip. We could flip only that transition. It's extremely hard to do because it takes a long time and very little power. But when you look at this, only hitting that transition means, what does it mean? Essentially, it says, flip my second bit if and, actually, let's say, well, yeah, okay. Flip my first bit if and only if my second bit is in state up. What is this? C naught, right? So this is a one quick way, not quick, but this is one way you could do a C naught. It's just by hitting this one transition. But it's very, very hard to hit only that single transition because it's very close to that other transition. So, you know, there's much more chance to, if whenever you hit that, you're going to hit the other one. Okay? So we're not going to do this for a control knot. And by the way, just for fun, can we hit this transition? Using only one single frequency? Maybe. In this case, no. Because it's something we call a forbidden transition. Okay? Whenever you create transition, no, it can always change. You can always change the spin by an amount of 1. And here you would change the spin by an amount of 2, because you flip both of them. Okay, so so it's forbidden by the laws of quantum mechanics. But you know, it was just an aside. So let's see how we can use a J coupling to do a C naught. So I could do that, but it's not practical. So let's not do this. Let's look at
the implication of this guy, of that new term. Let's see, for example, for fun, I'm going to call this. Okay. Let's see at what's going to be the dynamic of, let's say, my second spin, given that my first spin is in the up direction. Okay? So my Hamiltonian, so if my first spin is up, then the Hamiltonian would look like omega naught 1 plus omega naught 2 z2. It's not a square here, but plus, well, pi over 2 j z2. Because now, you know, it's an eigenstate 1, which is equal to, well, roughly speaking, so I can get rid of this thing because it's just a constant. It doesn't do anything to my Hamiltonian or to my dynamics. So what does that say? How is the dynamic of my second qubit different? There's an extra term here, right? Now my second spin looks like the same thing, but it has a Larmor frequency that is slightly augmented. Now if you look at the other one, minus. So again, we can forget that constant because it doesn't do anything. So now it has a slightly lower precession frequency. If you put the two together, it means that my second spin would process faster if my first spin is up, and would process slower if my first spin is down. This is a control operation, right? What happened here is directly related to what's going on there. So it's not a control knob per se, but it is a control operation. You can even think about it, it's a control Z operation. If you turn it on, if you let the coupling go on for long enough, then if the first spin is up, your second spin will rotate one way. Well, will rotate fast, the other one will rotate slower. So in some sense, if you put yourself right in the reference frame of the second spin, then if the first spin is up, then it will pick up some, it will pick up some angle, some rotation. And if the other pin is down, it will pick up rotation the other way. Okay. So if you keep it going long enough, you can create a separation of 180 degrees. So it's a control, in some sense, a control Z pi, rotation Z of pi. What's a control knot? A control knot is a control of a rotation around X of pi. So we're not at the control knot, but we're halfway there. Okay. So now that's your exercise. So in some sense, like when we work in the lab, because in the lab, we always work in the rotating frame. Okay? And because Z1 and Z2 commute with each other, we can simultaneously work in the two rotating frame. We can literally add a transformation that takes care of the first rotating frame and the second rotating frame. So what I'm saying is we can just see the new Hamiltonian as pi over 2 J Z1 Z2. Okay? So that a certain time evolution of u time j would be equal to e minus I theta actually not theta but t. Okay, and this just for definition, this pi over 2 j times tau, let's call it theta j. Sort of your rotation angle of coupling. Now I want you to, as an exercise tonight, show that if you do a y rotation of pi over 2 followed by a time delay of tau is equal to 1 over j followed by I want you to show that this. If you do a rotation of 90 degrees around y on the second qubit, followed by a J-coupling evolution for time 1 over j, then with those things, then you get a control knot up to a phase, up to a global phase. So if you look at this, it actually really makes sense. Okay? Because remember what I said, like this looks like, let's say if you start with your first spin in the plane, then it would, if my first spin is up, it will kind of flip it that way. If my second spin is down, it will flip it this way. Okay? So it's kind of the part here. Then there's the part there, so that you want to rotate back all your spin. So now you've literally done a control pi rotation around Z. Right, started there, it flipped like this, control back. And then if you want to do a control knot, which is a control X rotation, then you just sandwich everything by a Y rotation. So you flip it back. So now at that point, it's not a control Z, but it's a control X. And that one here, I don't really have a good intuition to explain it. It's just to make sure that all the phase work correctly to give you a control knot, per se. It's kind of intuitive. It's not black magic too much. Right? So now I want to go back. Good. I want to go back to measurement. Page 10. So normally, I only talk about this during the lab session, but I found out it was taking too much time and it was becoming unclear, so I figured we could spend about half an hour or so talking about it. So, the first thing to mention, so everything I've been talking about right now could apply to a single nuclei in a single molecule. Everything I've done so far could work too. Unfortunately, we don't have the technology to detect the state of a single nuclei. The technology is not there. No, the magnetic field of a single nucleus is very, very small. Nowadays, we have the technology for an electron spin, but an electron spin is about 2,000 times stronger than a nuclei spin. So what we do instead, what we have to do in quantum in NMR, is we use an ensemble of molecule. Okay? And this is where NMR becomes inherently different than the quantum information you've seen so far. Quantum information you've seen so far, we deal with single qubit, we do projective measurement, it gives you a random answer, it's all nice and dandy. Now we deal with about 10 to the 10 to 10 to the 20 exact copy of the same molecule. And the only reason we have to do this is to have enough polarization, enough magnetization to detect. Okay? So all the dynamics still apply. All the change will happen in how the way we're going to measure and how we're going to treat the initial state. Okay? So when you take a spin, and when you take a sample and put it in the magnetic field, technically, the low, you would think that the lowest energy state would be everything pointing up. It's not quite, and I'll explain you how in just a minute. But you can think of it as they will start pointing in every direction, But on average, there would be a net magnetization that will point along the external magnetic field. That's initially. There will be a net. You know, it's pretty small, but it's there and you can detect it. And at that point, even though all the spin point in different direction, they all have precession frequency and things, if you flip them all by pi over 2, let's say, then also the net magnetization will also flip by pi over 2. So you can sort of see the net magnetization as your qubit. Okay? Now, if you flip the magnetization around, in the XY plane, let's say, then your net magnetization will start rotating around. It will start processing around the magnetic field. And it will create, so if you have a magnet or magnetic moment processing around, you're creating a rotating magnetic field, which you can pick up using a pickup coil, because you create a rotating magnetic field, then you will create an AC current in the wire, which you can plug to an amplifier and then plug to an oscilloscope and measure. So this is, in a nutshell, how we're going to measure signal in NMR. We measure an ensemble signal by picking up their processing magnetization using the exact same pickup coil, the exact same coil that we use for controlling it. It goes through different electronics because we need more amplification in Yagi data, but it's the same piece of equipment. Right? So we can detect. So in some sense, at the equilibrium, when you put the sample in there, you wait long enough. Normally, typically, let's say a minute or two. It will what we call relax. So it will go to its thermal equilibrium state. And normally the thermal equilibrium state, as soon as you, and so you put the sample, the magnetic field is not on, and then you flip the magnetic field on. Of course, that's not how it goes in the lab because it takes days to flip the magnetic field on. But let's say if you put the sample, which is unpolarized, it will kind of polarize as what magnetization of equilibrium, 1 minus E to minus T over T1. So it will sort of, it will start at zero polarization and then saturate as a function of T. And T1 is what we call the spin lattice relaxation, okay? And here, spin lattice, not everybody uses it. That's what we call relaxation. Essentially, any type of physical system, no matter how you control it and whatever, if you let it go and you wait long enough, it will always re-equilibrate to its thermal equilibrium, okay? Sometimes it can be seconds. Some system is hours. Some system can be years. One experiment that you will actually do in the lab is measure this relaxation lattice. Okay? Because in some sense, this relaxation time tells you how many times you actually have to do control before your system relaxes. So if you want to do quantum computing, you want to make sure that you have time to do all your computation much faster than T1. Because after T1, like, your systems start relaxing and then you lose information. So what we're going to do in the lab is we're going to let the system relax. So it's going to have a big magnetization. Then we're going to do a pi pulse, flip it back, wait, and then do a measurement. I'll explain in a second how we do the measurement. Flip it back and wait and wait and wait. And actually, if you just work out the math very simply, you will find that, you know, as a function of time, it was equal, I always forget where the 2 is. So we'll do an experiment and we'll be able to measure this as a function of time. And by fitting the curve, the experimental curve that we're going to see, because now this thing looks more like, right, where here it's minus m equilibrium. we can be able to fit that curve, and just by simple least square fit or whatever, we'll be extracting the value of T1. And that gives us a lot of information about our system. So that's just to keep something in mind for a formula to keep in mind for Thursday. But okay, now I still haven't talked about how do we freaking detect things. So I told you that we, sort of the hand-wavy argument that we can make the polarization in the XY plane, make it spin around, and then we can detect it. So that's what we're doing, literally. Is what we do is we detect the magnetic field, the magnetization around X. I just want to be consistent here. Which now, let's say in a simple experiment, let's just say I let my system relax, and then I flip it around Y. So I do a 90 degree around Y, so I flip it along the X axis. Okay, and then it starts rotating. So I'm expecting to measure something like M equilibrium times cosine of omega naught T if I measure the X polarization. If I measure the Y polarization, so now you can tell me, like, okay, what do you call X and what do you call Y? I'm not going to answer the question just yet. But you can start playing tricks, actually, and if you would just want. So this is just if I do a, if I just flip the equilibrium back. But in general, even though if you start from any general state, here, I forgot that. I will explain in just a second what those means. Okay. So here, I mean, that one, I didn't just pull it out of a hat. Just imagine that you have a magnetization that just points anywhere in the plane, and just let it start rotate, and then figure out after a certain amount of time how much X and how much Y you will have. You will find out that you lose polarization of X as a function of cosine, and you gain some in the X as a function of the Y sine. It's just rotating. There's nothing magic around it. Now, what is this e to the minus t over t2? What is this new thing? Well, There's many factor, and actually on Friday you will see that finding out what the T2 is made of is a whole problem on its own. But in some sense, remember I said that if you wait long enough, it will always relax. Okay? The relaxed state or the thermal equilibrium state, the net magnetization point only along the x-axis. So if initially you have a magnetization that points somewhere, then it has to kind of lose its magnetization in the plane, okay? So T2 is inevitably related to T1, okay? So actually T2 is smaller or equal to 2T1. Yeah, 2T1, and that's the theoretical limit. Theoretical limit, it means that even though you do the perfect thing, everything is fine and dandy, you will T2 will always has to be at least smaller or equal than 2T1. Just from that fact that because you relax, you need to lose your transverse polarization. But T2 can encapsulate also a whole bunch of other things. And in NMR, it's a fairly easy thing to imagine. So you have, 10 to the 10 molecule that supposedly behave the exact same way. But the sample of liquid you'll see is about this size high by about this big. There's a few milliliters in it. That magnetic field that we apply, it's a big clunky magnet. Okay, it looks like a keg. It's this big. But it's, you know, it's very impossible to have the magnetic field to be exactly homogeneous through the whole sample, right? It's very homogeneous, maybe 10 to the 6, 10 to the 7 homogeneous, but we have stuff going at, you know, 10 to the 8, 10 to the 9, you know, megahertz, hundreds of megahertz. So what I'm saying here is that a molecule, let's say at the top of the sample, might have a slightly lower precession frequency than a molecule at the bottom, a nuclei at the bottom. So what's going to happen is imagine our sample is only two spin and two molecule. So normally, if they had the exact same field, then they will rotate at the same frequency, and their field will always add up. So now, if one of them has a Larmor frequency that is slightly slower than the other one, then what's going to happen is going to go like this. Then you're going to start moving away. So now if your two spin are this, so I turn around, and if the two spin are, in, now one of them is here, one of them is there, when you add them together along x, then the x is a little shorter. And then as they move apart, then they start, you know, drifting apart. So essentially, that's what happened because of inhomogeneity in the magnetic field. So as your spins start moving, they start spreading apart so that at some point they all cancel each other out. And that's another big factor in T2. Actually, that one, when you take this into account, is called T2 star. Because it turns out that you can cancel that effect, which I may have time to talk about soon. Okay. How can we measure X? How can we measure Y? Why do we call X? Why do we call Y? We're not quite there yet. The only thing that matters right now is we know that X and Y are perpendicular. Okay. By doing some electronics trick, we can do what we call quadrature detection. This is just a fancy word to say that we can detect a signal and extract the two perpendicular components, or with a phase of 90 degrees in between. Essentially, we can pick up the X phase and the X signal and the Y signal and spin it out as a complex number. Okay. So my electronics, it takes the signal, split it into quadrature, so split it, you know, mix it with two phases at 90 degrees, and then recombine it in a vector with complex number in it. The real number is whatever we call X, and then the complex number, whatever we're going to call Y. Okay? And here, if you look at that, well, you know, you're going to have the real number will be your X magnetization, the imaginary will be the Y. Keep that in mind for now. Now we're going to, before starting to look at what we're going to measure in the lab, we need to know what is a thermal equilibrium state of our system. So as I said, we no longer only have one molecule now, or one spin in one molecule, but we have an ensemble of spin that are identical. They behave identically, but it's still an ensemble. And when we talk about ensemble, we talk about the Boltzmann distribution. If you have done statistical mechanics or maybe some thermal physics, you will have seen it. If you haven't seen it, no worries. What the Boltzmann distribution says is that a system in the thermal equilibrium, the probability of being in a certain state with a certain energy is proportional to e to the minus e over kBT, where kB is the Boltzmann factor. And then now I'm just going to use the term beta is equal to 1 over kBT, just for shorthand. Okay, so that's what it says. So So in my system here, okay, so let's keep on going. So let's say I have a system with many energies and you know, many possible energies. So what that means is that if I look at my density matrix, remember yesterday we talked at that at length. The density matrix is just the sum of all the probability of giving a state times the outer product of that state. So the density matrix will be proportional to the sum over all my possible energy state with a certain energy eigenvalue of P of EI. Okay, this is just a definition. Actually, it's not proportional. This is equal. And this will be proportional to the sum over all EI of e to the minus EI, beta EI and that's what Boltzmann says. So now if we do a quick trick. Because this part is right in front of an outer product of an eigenstate, I can change it to the Hamiltonian. This is equal. Then you can factor in the Hamiltonian in front because it's just an operator. What is this equal to? A sum over all the possible outer product of all my possible state is the identity, right? You know, if you have any orthonormal basis and you sum all the outer product, that's called the resolution of identity. So I should say this is proportional. So in some sense, what I'm saying is that the thermal equilibrium state is proportional to this, to make sure that to take the proportionality constant into account, the trace of this has to be equal to zero, so the proportionality constant is 1 over the trace. That doesn't really matter. We're not going to get rid of that now. But when you have an ensemble of molecules in a thermal equilibrium, this holds. It's not just an NMR. This holds. And that was just a very simple argument from probability. Okay? So now what we're saying is that in NMR, our thermal equilibrium state is proportional. Let's forget the bottom run, right? So this is an exponential of an operator. So Michele discussed that yesterday. So we're going to have, it's proportional to the identity minus beta H plus beta squared A squared over 2 plus yada, yada, yada. Okay? Beta at room temperature is very small. 1 over kBT for a temperature of 300 Kelvin is like 10 to the minus 5. So the next term, 10 to the minus 10, it's 5 order of magnitude. So we can literally just approximate it out. Okay? And at room temperature, it's a very good approximation. So which means that it's 1 minus beta, and then my Hamiltonian is omega. So I'll just do it for 2, just for fun. We'll go 1, Z1, plus omega naught 2, Z2, plus pi j over 2, Z1, Z2. Omega naught is in the millions. J is in the hundreds. So we can get rid of that too. So up to an overall constant factor. So that's our initial state. Okay. So if you really look at this, what it tells me is my thermal initial state is a very mixed state. Mostly unknown. There's very little polarization. Everything is an identity state. But there's a tiny bit of polarization on my first spin, but Z1 is Z1 times tensor product identity. Okay, so essentially it's saying that I have a little bit of polarization on my first spin with a completely mixed second spin. And also a little bit of polarization on my second spin with a little bit of with completely mixed state on my first spin. So it's a highly, highly undefined thermal state, especially for quantum information. And we will see that actually this is one of the big shortcomings of NMR, is that the initial state is highly mixed, and it's extremely hard to create the polarization you need just to initialize your system. Actually, it's so hard that you need to use you cannot use unitary operation to do that. You need to use non-unitary operation, non-linear approach. But we probably won't have time to talk about that for now. Okay, so now the point where so this is just to show the initial state. What I really want to get at is the actual measurement part. So, and in some sense here, right, the identity. So that's where you might get confused. Okay? It's not that confusing, but I'm just going to warn you. The identity here, whether you can apply any unitary operation you want on it, it will never change. Identity always goes to the identity. And this will never create any polarization whatsoever. So in NMR, we usually drop it. So I will usually use, and we drop all the constant. That's where we start being very hand wavy. Okay. We're going to refer to this as our density matrix. But don't confuse, like, this is what we call the deviation density matrix, that part in excess of the identity. But it's, mathematically speaking, it cannot be a density matrix because it has trace of zero. Okay? So when I work in NMR and I use those type of notation, always remind yourself that there's a big identity in front. But that identity doesn't do anything, so there's no point of carrying it around. Okay. So, back to measurement. The magnetization around X, literally up to a certain constant, this is just my expectation value of my state along the X direction, which, as we saw yesterday, trace of X times rho. Same thing with y. So now, and I say in quadrature, we can detect this, which is the trace of x plus I y times rho. And this guy here is what we call the raising operator, and it's quite, if you look at it, it's a raising operator because it brings a down to an up and an up to nothing. Okay. So this obviously it's not a real variable. This is not an observable because it's not an outer product of, it's not a zero cross zero or one cross one, but when we do, this is classical post-processing to add that little I together. This is similar to measuring this. Okay? So in NMR, the output that you get, the output that your computer get is this. Okay? So that's what we're going to see on the computer, and that's what I want to talk about, how we're going to see it. Again, I did all the calculation in there. Please feel free to look at them, but I'm just going to state the facts. Now, if you take any initial state whatsoever, let's say you do a control you do your operation and stuff, and you end up with a state that you want to measure.
Your state will always be, you will always be able to write it up.
You can always write it this way. And it's as simple as, you know, the matrix 1, the x, the y, the z is a basis for the 2x2 matrix, so you can always write it this way.
So I said in NMR we will never see that, so let's forget about it. So if you start at row 0, right? So as a function of time during the measurement, as a function of time, it will evolve with respect to that's a time evolution of a density operator. Oh, yeah, there's a plus. You're right. Absolutely right. Actually, I wanted to do a plus, but I stopped halfway through. I got lazy. So you crunch a number. You figure out how it evolved. Yada, yada. You push. What you find out at the end is that the trace of sigma plus rho t is equal to alpha e to the plus I beta e to the plus I omega t. Okay? And this kind of makes sense with what we're expecting. We say we can only measure the transversal, magnetization. So that's why in the signal we pick up, there's only some alpha and beta. There's no gamma. So we cannot detect anything that is along the z-axis. Okay? And here we can kind of see that in your signal, you get some information about how much of polarization you have along z-x, because you have the alpha here, and how much along y, because you have the beta there. So this contains all the information you need. So actually, experimentally, right? When you look at this, that will give you, some density matrix. So I will not go into detail of why that is, but experimentally, and actually we talked a little bit about that yesterday, is that as time goes on, there's decoherence. Remember I said the off-diagonal start disappearing? So you're going to pick up a exponential decay on the side. And if you walk through those things, you'll find out that it shows up as a factor. So now we have a decaying oscillating function. And this is equal to what? This is equal to alpha plus IB e to the I omega naught t minus t over t2. Okay? So you can look, at the imaginary part and the real part, you'll find out it's some sort of decaying sine or cosine. Okay, where the decay is e to minus 2 over t2, the frequency is omega naught. Analyzing periodical function is kind of a pain if you analyze it in the time domain. So normally when you have periodical function, the first thing that should pop in your mind is Fourier transform. Everybody, has everybody seen the Fourier transform? Yes? Anybody didn't see the Fourier transform? All right. So as a reminder, Fourier transform is how to express a time domain into a frequency domain. So f of omega is equal to the integral from 0 to infinity of e to minus I omega t, f of t, dt. And if you do the Fourier transform of a decaying exponential, you get if we put this as a f of t, we get 1 over
1 over T2 plus I omega naught over omega 2, which has a real and an imaginary part. The real is okay. So this is what we measure, and this is what you will see. The electronics picks up the signal in quadrature, takes a Fourier transform, and give you a graph of the real and a graph of the imaginary part. And if you plot this, it looks something like that. I'm very good at drawing, but actually, it's normally much more sharp than this. But and this is center at omega naught. And the imaginary part looks like, is it up first or? Yeah. Will look like, again, it's supposed to be symmetric. And it crossed here at omega naught. And here, for example, the full width at half max is equal to 2 over T2. So by analyzing this, you pick up some information about T2. But those are what it looks like. So when you pick up, so if you look at this, right? There's an alpha. So this is phi of t. So when you look at your actual signal, let's call it s, then you will get, you know, alpha plus I beta times the, by the way, this is not b, this is called d. This, the a, we call it an absorption curve. The d, we call it a dispersion curve. Why? I don't know. This is the way it is. Plus I d, so that will be equal to, you know, alpha a minus I beta d times absorption plus, what am I doing? Plus I beta absorption minus beta, am I an idiot? Alpha D. Plus, same thing. No, not same thing. So what we see from there is if we just look at the real part, at the Fourier transform of the real part, it will contain information about both alpha and beta. And remember, alpha is how much of x you had at the beginning and how much of y you had at the beginning. So when you look at this, the real part of the Fourier transform you get, and you can fit, you can do it sometime by eye. Well, actually, we'll see that we have tools for doing that. And you look at how much absorption and how much dispersion you have, you can find the relation between alpha and beta. So you've measured how much of x and how much of y you get by looking at this signal. So this is how you do measurement in NMR. And now, to answer your question, how do you deal with what you call x and what you call y? The first time you do an experiment, you will get something that is completely whack. Okay, it will point in any direction. But the one thing you know is the first time you do an experiment is you start in the Zen, and you apply, you tell your electronics, send a pulse with a phase of pi over 2, a 90-degree phase. So a y pulse. So if you do a y pulse, you expect your signal to be on the x, right? So you expect your signal to look like this only. So then you take your signal, you look at it, it looks all weird. Then you can rephase, so you know, just using your computer, you can post-process it, change the phase between the real and the imaginary so that your system, so that your spectrum looks like that. And then you click that phase, and that's how you calibrate the phase of your Fourier transform with the phase of your electronics to call X, X. And that would be, so, you know, there's no absolute X and there's no absolute Y. We do everything relative and we stick to it. And that's how we use our definition to stick to it, is by looking at the signal and rephasing our Fourier transform properly.